Good morning. I want to welcome all of you to worship with the Community Church of Sebastopol, an open and affirming congregation in the United Church of Christ. Our mission is to worship God and share the love of Jesus Christ, teaching the way of Jesus to all ages and putting our faith into action. Today is the 14th Sunday after Pentecost, and we continue our summer series of worship with the theme, Woven Back Together. Thank you to all who are leading worship this morning, to our ushers, to our handbell ensemble, and to our tech team. And I want to just make a brief, fun announcement that one of our tech teamers, Aaron Knuth, turns 18 tomorrow. Congratulations, Aaron. And I also want to say a special thank you to Dorothy McCoyne, who is our liturgist this morning, and also one of our ringers. There she is. So if you, at some point in the service, when you hear a voice and you're not sure where it's coming from Dorothy right over there. A special welcome to those of you who are worshiping with us for the first time. We're very glad to have you here. We also hope to gather some contact information from you. And our ushers have a pad, and they're collecting that information. And to those who are joining us online, we're really happy that you are part of our worship service today. We'd love to know that you participated, so please leave a greeting in the chat section. The image on the cover of the bulletin is of a purple thistle, scientific name Sersium horridulum, common in Missouri and surrounding states. I picked this image because it reminded me of the word epistle. Thistle, epistle. Epistle meaning letter, and we've been doing readings from the letters last week and this week. But I also learned that this plant is both invasive and prolific, beautiful and painful, and even illegal to intentionally grow in some states. And that kind of reminded me of the Word of God itself. So that's why there's a Sersium horridulum on the cover of the bulletin. In consideration of our most vulnerable community members and current guidelines, we're asking everyone to wear a mask and to practice physical distancing while gathered together. We do invite gentle congregational singing, and leaders may be removing our masks up here to facilitate clearer communication. Also, a few times in this service, you'll be invited to stand as you are willing and able. I want to say a special greeting. Every week or so, I see a person I haven't seen in a long, long time. Margaret Murakami is with us this morning. It's so wonderful to have you back, Margaret. As we begin our worship in this sacred place, we want to respectfully acknowledge that our church's sanctuary is located on traditional land of the Southern Pomo and Coast Miwok peoples, who have stewarded this land for generations. And now I invite you to look to your bulletin and to respond to me in our call to worship. Beloved, as we prepare to worship, let us remember whom we worship. We worship God, our creative source, the passionate lover of our souls, and our life everlasting. Let us worship our creating, loving, and living God.
Our time of Confession is a time for us to be honest with ourselves, with one another, and with God, that there are wounds in this world in need of healing. And we come together and lift up these prayers in the care of our community, in the steadfast love of God, so that we can more fully understand how we have been a part of those wounds and how we can be a part of the healing. So let us pray. Freedom-loving God, you call us to be doers of the word, not hearers only. You call us to love the world with your passion and to let that love be expressed in justice, forgiveness, and peace.
Forgive us when our hearts are constricted with fear and when we do not let your transforming grace open us to the world you cherish. Forgive us when we honor you only with lip service and not with the fullness of our lives.
Let's take a moment of silent prayer. Friends, God in Christ has shown us the ways of mercy, love, and peace. Our words and our actions are part of God's cosmic process of making all things new. Filled with grace, we can fall in love with God's world again so that we can offer and experience forgiveness, reconciliation, and hope. Amen.
And now I invite you in body or in spirit to stand and we'll share a sign of Christ's peace. All right, I invite you to look to the left of you and say, peace be with you. Peace be with you. And look to the right of you and say, peace be with you. Look above you and say, peace be with you. Look below you and say, peace be with you. Look in front of you and say, peace be with you. Look behind you and say, peace be with you. May the peace of Christ be with you all. Amen.
And while you're having a seat, will you please stand as you're able and look to the insert in your order of worship and join us in the opening song. We sing your mighty power, O God.
We sing the wisdom that ordained the sun.
Okay, who here is familiar with Simon Says? Anybody who's not familiar? It's just, so I'm going to offer some invitations, and you get to respond. See how our mics are doing? however you want. So do this however's most comfortable in your body. And our gospel, or our scripture story today comes from James. So instead of Simon Says, we're going to do James Says. So participate however you're comfortable. So let's see. James says, touch your nose. James says, wiggle your fingers. James says, turn around. I got tangled up in my cord. James says, stick out your left foot. James says, hop up and down. James says, feed the world. Oh, got some gestures. Any other, what are some other ways that we might feed the world? Maybe like share some resources, is that all right? I love it. So the scripture, we're talking a lot about hearing the word, but also doing the word. And some things like touch your nose, maybe that's easier when we hear it. We're like, I know what that means. That means put my finger here on my nose. But feed the world, there might be lots of different interpretations. I saw our arms going out in generosity, maybe some sharing some resources. There are lots of different ways to respond. So that's part of what we're exploring today in the scripture is how are all the different ways that we can live into God's calling for us. So let's try a few more. James says, nod your head. James says, wash your hands. James says, follow Jesus. Oh. So maybe we have some prayers. We have some movement, some like actions. Any other ways that we follow Jesus? I see a heart, spreading love. Lots of different ways to follow Jesus, to follow the words that James is going to share with us this day. So thank you for playing a little James Says. Oh, do you want to stay up here and we'll just pray together? Thank you. Let us pray. God, thank you for all of the callings that you have placed on our hearts, for all of the ways that you invite us to be your love and freedom in this world. And we lift up all of these joys, this gratitude to you, saying together the prayer that your Son Jesus taught us, our Creator, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debt as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Thank you all.
Testing this mic. Okay, it works. Thank you, Hinbell Ensemble. Thank you, tech team, for troubleshooting in the midst of our service. Today's scripture reading is another epistle reading. Kind of rhymes with thistle. Epistle reading, the epistle of James. And you may hear, if you read through the letter of James, you may realize it's a very different tone and in some ways theology than most of the other letters written by the Apostle Paul. This letter from James is a bit different. So listen to what might sound different in this reading as Dorothy and I share it with you. The first chapter of James, verses 17 through 27.
Every generous act of giving, every perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variation or shadow due to change.
In fulfillment of God's own purpose, God gave us birth by the word of truth, so that we would become a kind of first fruits of God's creatures.
You must understand this, my beloved. Let everyone be quick to listen, slow to speak, slow to anger. For your anger does not produce God's righteousness.
Therefore, rid yourselves of all sordidness and rank growth of wickedness, and welcome with meekness the implanted word that has the power to save your souls.
Be the doers of the word, and not merely hearers who deceive themselves.
For if any are hearers of the word, but not doers, they are like those who look at themselves in a mirror. For they look at themselves and, on going away, immediately forget what they were like.
Ah, but those who look into the perfect law, the law of liberty, and persevere, being not hearers who forget, but doers who act, they will be blessed in their doing.
If any think they are religious and do not bridle their tongues but deceive their hearts, their religion is worthless.
Religion that is pure and undefiled before God the Father is this: to care for orphans and widows in their distress, and to keep oneself unstained by the world.
Here ends the reading of Scripture. If this text is like a mirror reminding us who we are, let us not forget who we are when we turn away, but become those blessed in the doing of the word. Amen. Thank you, Dorothy, for assisting me in that reading. Sometimes it's helpful to hear scripture as a dialogue between voices. So often we hear it as a monologue of one person, but these texts belong to the community, and they've been part of the ongoing dialogue that the Christian community has been having for millennia. Before I continue, I just want to take a moment, because I have a wonderful seat right here, to look at our Dawn Redwood, which is not common. And it got my attention today, and I just wanted to point it out to you. And it's just beautiful. And even to the way that the entire trunk of the tree is covered with lichen. And now, if you ask any of the grounds people, it's not their favorite tree, because it has a lot to say at certain times of year. Whether it's pollen or dropping all of its little seed casings and whatnot. But right now it's glorious. And I just wanted to share with you that I've been taking up a practice, especially when the smoke is thicker in the air, and I get that sense of, at best it's disconcertedness, at worst it's doom. And in those moments, what I've started to do is I've looked for life. And I was looking out my kitchen window the other day, and the smoke had gotten thicker, and I looked out and I thought, I am looking right now at thousands of forms of life just outside my kitchen window. So in the midst of smoke and haze and feelings of being disconcerted or even doom, life abounds. And I feel like in our faith, we need to constantly be looking for the life, even as we don't turn our backs from the places of death. Amen? Yeah. All right, that's my little mini sermon to begin with. But I wanted to delve into this epistle of James. You might know that the epistle of James was famously called by Martin Luther what? Oh, nobody knows? The Epistle of Straw. It would be like him saying, this epistle is like if somebody set before you a feast of plain iceberg lettuce. Eat your fill. Luther thought there was no nutrition in it. There was no purpose to it. So you might know that then Luther threw all of his hope and faith into the epistles of Paul. See, when Luther looked at the epistle of James, he saw it as saying the exact opposite of what Paul was saying. Paul was speaking to the Gentile world throughout Asia Minor and what is now Greece and what is now Italy. And he was speaking to that world and he was saying what matters most, really the thing that matters is faith, is trust in the God of Israel and in his son, Jesus Christ. And if you have that faith, you are not constrained by the law anymore. So belief in Christ is a full freedom. You are now released from bondage. Does this sound like Pauline language that you might recognize? When Luther met or read James, what he heard is that faith is not the most important thing. It's balanced out with what we do. That faith alone, what is that? It's just words. It's just an individual head trip. It has to be coupled with actions. And when Martin Luther read this, he thought, then you're throwing away grace. You're throwing away the promise that God loves you no matter what. You're putting conditions back in the place. Do you hear the difference in the message? This is why he called it the Feast of Iceberg Lettuce. It seems that the Pauline community and the Jamesian community were looking at one thing in very different ways, the law, the Torah. The Pauline communities were asserting that while God had given the law to the Jews, no one can be saved by trying to keep all of the rules of the law. But rather, freedom is found in realizing that apart from the law, you are loved by God through your faith in God. And James, however, was speaking to a Jewish community. The very beginning of the letter, it says, James is speaking to the 12 tribes of the diaspora, the 12 Jewish tribes that are now dispersed throughout the world, at least the world that was known within that community. And speaking to a Jewish community, James did not want to throw out the law, but James wanted to redefine the law as not a law that constrains, but a law that makes true freedom possible. James might say that if you are just released from all constraints, that's not freedom, that's chaos. You need to have a trustworthy law that then enables you to act on behalf of God and on behalf of the neighbor. And so there are some different views of freedom that we experience in contrasting these two Christian theologies. And yeah, I say two Christian theologies because oftentimes we want to think there's just kind of one Christian way of seeing things, and all of the scriptures are going to prove that one way. But in mature Christianity, you realize that it's a dialogue. It's a debate. There are contradictions. There are different assertions on offer, not just one offer. And so today I want to talk a little bit about this view of freedom. In the text we read today, James calls it the law of freedom. The law of freedom. And I want to suggest that we can talk about freedom in lots of different ways, but in one sense we can talk about there being a freedom from and a freedom to. Sometimes philosophers call it a negative freedom and a positive freedom. Freedom from means that you are freed from constraints, freed from obligations, freed from prisons, freed from oppression, freed from constricting rules or laws or mores that are seeking to keep a person or a group of people in control. That is negative freedom. So to be released from something would be freedom. And then positive freedom is the freedom to do something. Once you are able to do something, the freedom to then choose to do that thing. I'm going to share a rather mundane example to let you know what I'm talking about. Several years ago, I had a bottle of Roundup in my hand. And I thought, I am freed from constraints. I had the resources to purchase this bottle of Roundup. I am able-bodied enough to squeeze the trigger. I have my eye on some weeds. I want to get rid of those weeds. I am now free from the constraints, and I can now spray this Roundup on the weeds in my yard. But then I had a little voice of conscience saying, now what do I know about this Roundup? What do I know about the company that produces it? What do I know about living things that live downstream? What do I know about biologically engineered chemicals? And I thought, even though I can spray this Roundup, no one would see me, and I have the freedom to do it, I might choose not to do it. That day, I did it. I did it. I had it in my hand, I had the conversation with myself, and then I sprayed it, killed those weeds. I don't think I've used it since. So somehow the conversation went down deep enough, but maybe not in that exact moment. When we are freed from constraints, we are then offered freedoms to do things. But just because we are free to do them does not mean that we are required to do them. But so often when we are freed from those constraints, we do it anyway. I think this is the story of the second story of creation in Genesis. Adam and Eve are told, don't eat of one tree, that tree, the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And Adam and Eve were like, we're cool with that. And then the serpent came and said, you know, you're not going to die. You can do this. And once they could do it, did they do it? Yes. That's the problem, the challenge, the struggle of human freedom, that so often when we are freed from constraints and given new choices, we often exercise those choices in the direction of freedom. But we need to be honest that in our culture, there are very different experiences of freedom. And it often has to do with power. If you are a person or a community of privilege, you are freed from certain constraints that other communities are not. You have certain resources at your disposal. You have a certain support of the legal and political and economic structures to then enact what you want to do. This is why in our culture we are coming to grips with the power of white supremacy or white superiority. That white people in our culture are freed from more constraints than are people of color. Which is why white people and people of color, when they talk about freedom, you might notice they're talking about it in different kinds of ways. When white people often talk about freedom, what they're talking about is the freedom to do whatever they want without considering the neighbor. And so often when people of color are talking about freedom, they're talking about being freed from the constraints of economic, political, legal oppression. So freedom is experienced very differently depending on one's relative power in the world. You might remember Martin Luther King Jr.'s final speech. It was on the eve of his death. There are a lot of famous lines from that speech, but I learned recently, or it was pointed out to me, an aspect of that speech that I had not heard before. In that speech, on the very last night of his life, he looked out at his community. They had just, they were there in Memphis to protest on behalf of the sanitation workers, and that day of protest had not gone well. It seemed as if it was going to spiral into violence. And so they gathered up the community, and he was speaking to them, and he wanted to point out to them the kind of power that they had that they didn't know that they had. And he pointed out to them that at that time, African Americans in America had more accumulated wealth than the entire nation of Canada. So he was letting the people know that they had a power that they didn't know that they had. He was releasing them from a constraint that they thought had held them down, and now he was giving them a new choice. And his new choice was not to buy Coca-Cola. He was introducing to them the power of boycott, using the power that they had that they did not know that they had. In the epistle of James, I think James is calling this kind of work that King and the community were doing at that time, I think he would call it moving from being hearers of the word to doers of the word. Because it's one thing to hear about freedom and how wonderful freedom is and how everybody should be free. It's another thing to be shown your power so that you can enact that freedom in a concrete way on behalf of yourself and others. But I want to point out a detail to this text that, unless you're fluent in Greek, Tony, you might have missed it. I'm not fluent in Greek, so I missed it too. I had to look it up. But I thought, what is this word doers? I wonder where that comes from. You know what the word is? Poesia. 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 What does it sound like? Poetry. Poetry. So what James is saying is, don't just be hearers of the word who kind of passively hear the word and nod along. Become poets of the word. Make your life an expression of the word that you are hearing. Let it flow through you. Do what poets do, that taking the ordinary stuff around you, the ordinary stuff of life, bits of words and phrases, a dawn red tree, redwood tree, a gathering of community, the smoke in the air, a beloved member coming back after 17 months away. Take that little stuff of life, all those concrete, incarnated things, and let them flow through you. Become doers, become poets of the word. Don't let the word stop in you. Let it flow through you. I think that is what James is talking about when he talks about the law of freedom, the freedom to allow the word to flow through you through decisions that line up with your deepest commitments. So I want to introduce you to a poet of the word that I did not know a year ago. Her name is Prathia Hall. Anybody here ever hear of Prathia Hall? I know Pastor Lacey has. Anybody? Oh, that's why I'm introducing her. Everyone should know who Prathia Hall is. When I started to learn about Prathia Hall, I realized I don't know how I don't know about her. You know why I didn't? Because I didn't need to. I didn't want to. I didn't think to. But now I know, and I want to be a poet of some of the words that she has given us. Prathia Hall was a pastor, a preacher, a prophet, a professor. She was born in 1940 in Philadelphia. She was a civil rights activist, and she wasn't just any civil rights activist. Many scholars say that Dr. King came up with his phrase, "I have a dream," after hearing Prathia Hall preach. Prathia Hall, an African-American woman. Martin Luther King said, she is the one person I don't want to have to follow when I'm speaking. But we haven't heard about Prathia Hall. And yet, Prathia Hall is and should become an even greater reference point in our understanding of the civil rights movement that continues to this day. Prathia Hall's signature formulation she called freedom faith. Freedom faith, with a little hyphen in between. It was one thought with two pieces to it. Freedom, a secular thought about what we've been talking about, freedom from constraints and freedom to choose on behalf of yourself and others in your community. And then faith, trusting that God is a God of freedom. God is a God who wills and desires freedom for all the people. I want to share just a few words of Prathia's from a sermon of hers called Freedom Faith. Freedom faith, Prathia says, is a faith in freedom. A faith for freedom. Grounded in the absolute, positive, without a doubt conviction that God intended all people to be free. That God had brought them to that time and that place and that hour in history to boldly confront the bedrock forces of segregation and racial injustice. Freedom faith. For Prathia Hall, there was no faith that wasn't freedom faith. Faith that was just kind of generic faith, didn't have a direction. And that was no freedom at all. Faith must be freedom faith. It must be a faith in a God of freedom who desires freedom and that provides ways out of constraints and oppression into new zones of freedom. And especially for the most marginalized and vulnerable people in our culture. And this is exactly where James is going with his letter. James himself says, this is what religion is. Pure and undefiled religion, this is what it is. To care for orphans and widows in their distress and to keep oneself unstained by the world. In other words, true religion, if we dare to practice it, is concerned with those who have been left out of the economy and the politics and the legal system of the land we live in. That we who practice freedom faith are those who see ourselves as practicing an alternative to the wider structures and values of the world, who are pointing out ways in which we and others might have power that we didn't know that we had. And always elevating voices and people and movements that have yet to be heard. Freedom faith. Faith in freedom. Faith for freedom. Faith in a God who desires and is calling us into that freedom. Amen.
now as we enter a time of prayer together, our hearts are with Vicki Maester and Colby Bowman Maester as they mourn the passing of Stu Bowman, who died Friday evening. And I wonder what other prayers may be on your heart this morning.
Bobby.
Prayers for the firefighters, and may they have God's help in putting out these flames.
Prayers for the firefighters, that they may have God's help in fighting the fires and putting out these blazes. Nancy.
Prayers for Jeff Mullinex, who's going through a really hard time right now.
Prayers for Jeff, who's going through a hard time right now. Yeah, Jim. Yes, for the Marines and Navy corpsmen and all the service people who have died in Afghanistan. Yes. And the 170 civilians who were killed the same day. Prayers for our nation to receive these refugees with grace and with love. Amen. Well, let us gather ourselves in prayer. I invite you to take a deep breath, and if you feel comfortable, to close your eyes. And allow the next breath you take to fill up your whole belly. And you can release it slowly. And in your next breath, ask God to be with you in this breathing. And imagine God with each person in the circle. Imagine God surrounding each person who may be worshiping from home today. And for all people who are connected to our church and our community, imagine that they're connected to you right now. And into this breathing space, into this holy sanctuary, we pray. God, you are expansive. God, you are our sanctuary. God, you are enough. We ask your love and light to surround those who mourn. We lift up Vicki and Colby and the family of Lloyd Lerum. For grief is sacred, holy work. It is a sign that love has touched us. And so, God, we ask you to bless those who grieve. God, be with those who are sick. We pray your comfort will surround them and for your healing spirit to touch them with mercy. We pray for those who are most impacted by climate change, those in the path of hurricanes, fire, smoke, and floods. We pray for peace, peace in our world, peace in Afghanistan, peace in our families, peace within ourselves. And we pray for our nation and world leaders to care for the orphans and the widows of our day. Holy One, we share with you the prayers that have been spoken aloud this day and those that remain in the quiet of our hearts, trusting that you hear every prayer. And it is in the strong name of Jesus that we pray. Amen.
So today's scripture begins, "Every generous act of giving expresses God's light in the world." And as the handbell ensemble shares its offering of music, and as the ushers come among you to serve, let us share generously for the flourishing of our church. So we will now receive our morning offering. And let me just also add... She's got the mic. The song is called Softly and Tenderly. And I just think there's so much in every sermon that we hear. And sometimes you hear it, and then you think about it maybe later. But my hope is that our music can help you solidify what you heard today.
Thank you.
In body and spirit, please stand and join our voices together for the doxology. Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise God, all creatures here below. Praise God above, ye heavenly host, Creator Christ and Holy Ghost. Amen.
Looking to your bulletin, would you please respond to me in the prayer of dedication? Okay, let us pray. Loving God, thank you for your gifts of life, fragrant flowers, fruitful vines, singing creatures, and our own lives renewed in Christ.
Let your grace infuse the gifts we offer with life-giving power for those in need. In the name of the Creator, the Christ, and the Holy Spirit, we ask it. Amen.
Just a few announcements before we sing our closing hymn and receive our parting blessing. First of all, the chancel choir, directed by Andy Del Monte, meets Thursdays at 7 p.m. right over here in or near or around the choir room. And newcomers are always welcome, people of all ages and singing abilities. Also, anybody who thinks they might like to give a try at playing handbells, please talk to Karna Roa, our handbell ensemble director. She'd be happy to talk to you about that. I want to point out that our September newsletter, Salt and Light, just came out. You can either access that through the All Church email that you received, or there are some paper copies right back on the usher's table. Please take one on your way out. A few safe return updates. Small groups can begin meeting indoors, masked with our new air filtration systems on. We've got them in all the buildings now. Returning to indoor worship is still under consideration. Factors are many: weather, smoke, unvaccinated children, hybrid worship capabilities, trajectory of the pandemic. We're not ready to meet for worship indoors yet, but stay tuned for updates. The men's discussion group will be meeting a week from Tuesday, 11:30 to 1. This month, I will be facilitating a discussion on the relationship between faith and belief. Newcomers and visitors are always welcome. And we have an author among us who just had her new book released, Turn Left at the Big Ant Hill, a memoir by our own Rosemary Manchester. Congratulations. It's been a labor of love, and we have been anticipating this for a long time, and we're very happy for you and for all of us. You should stay tuned for an upcoming opportunity to buy a book, maybe get it signed, maybe even ask the author some questions about it. So please stay tuned for that. But congratulations, Rosemary. This is wonderful. Pastor Lacey, you have an announcement?
Yes, it is still not too late to sign up for the adult mission trip. So a small group of folks are going out to Paradise to help with some of the repair work there. It's September 19th through the 25th. So if you're interested in knowing more, contact Joyce Cox. Joyce is over here waving. If you're not familiar with Joyce, you can also email me. But look for information about the adult mission trip in September.
There will be a prayer beads workshop, a contemplative workshop where you can make your own prayer beads. It will be September the 13th, a Monday morning. Please RSVP to me. The women's retreat is coming up in October. You can save the date for October 9th. It will be a one-day Saturday retreat facilitated by Pastor Lacey and the Dr. Sharon Fenema. The theme is We Make the Road by Walking, and you can sign up by contacting Marge Holland, who's right here. Wave, Marge. Or you can email me, and I can give you some more details. And for our online community, and really for anyone, if you'd like to email me your prayer concerns by Friday, I will include them in our Sunday worship service.
Thank you. And Pastor Rachel, I would like to congratulate you, because not only tomorrow is not only your eldest's birthday, it's also your 6-year ordination anniversary. So congratulations. Your ministry among us has been a blessing. Our closing song is We Cannot Own the Sunlit Sky. Invite you, as you are able and comfortable and willing, to stand as we sing our closing hymn.
Now go with blessing to be poets of the word. In the name of God our Creator, Christ our Redeemer, and the Holy Spirit our Sustainer. Amen.